Hi, I'm Josh Wilson, and I wrote the song Before the Morning about my good friends Tim and Paula Beal, and I would love to share their story with you. Theirs is a story about the frailty of the human heart, a story about the struggles that we all face, but most of all, it's a story about hope.
Have to feel the things that hurt you. If there's a God who loves you, where is he now? Or maybe there are things you can't see, and all those things are happening to bring a better ending. Someday, somehow, you'll see, you'll see.
God gave me my first job working with student ministry for a church in Lubbock. Was there for about 3 years and then moved to a church right outside of Lubbock in Wolfrith, Texas, and was there for a little over four ministering, which is when this whole story kind of took place. Paul and I were married for 6 years, I'm sorry, 5 years, whenever we had our daughter, Madison, who was beautiful. Beautiful blonde hair, blue eyes, love and life, came out just an amazing, healthy, beautiful, smart little girl. She had done great, man, turned three, and we found out that we were gonna have another baby, and we were going through getting ready for what was gonna be hopefully our second child. And we went September 11th to find out what we were gonna have, and that's kind of when our world kind of crashed. The doctor started sonogramming, and the nurse kind of got quiet and walked us out and moved us into a different room. And they told us that there was something that wasn't right. They said they thought it was because of how he was laying, but that they couldn't find part of his heart. It's called hypoplastic left heart syndrome. And so instead of having a four-chamber heart, he had two chambers, and the side that he had lots of problems. A lot of the valves hadn't formed. His kidneys and his lungs weren't functioning properly, and they immediately took us to a doctor that that started suggesting that we have an abortion, and he told us that we would never be able to afford what was going to happen, and that even if we did, it would ruin our marriage because of the stress. And then he said that our son would never have a good quality of life, and I fell back on my faith, because I knew I didn't want to kill this baby that God had given us. And if he was going to be this gift of God we had prayed for, we were going to wait and see what God was going to do through his life. We didn't know what to do. But I remember the God that saved me in seventh grade, and I remembered all the things that I'd learned. And Paula said something to me that I don't even know if she remembers saying it, but she said, if we can trust God with our eternity, we've got to trust him with our now. And so we did. In January 11th, in Plano, our son was born. They wouldn't let us have him in Dallas because they didn't think he was gonna make it. We decided to name him Jacob David. We got Jacob from Old Testament. It's one of the pillars of Solomon's temple. And then we chose David because the meaning of the name is victory and grace through God's beloved. And we knew that he was loved by God and that we were gonna receive victory and grace through his life somehow. The problem with what his condition, with hypoplastic babies, the heart doesn't put any oxygen in the blood. And so his body has blood, it just doesn't have oxygen, and so they slowly start to suffocate. They said that he would have a 2% chance to live past 4 days. So at 4 days old, they begin a surgery on his heart to try to build it, to do something that it wasn't gonna do on its own. They couldn't really put in the side that wasn't there. Kept telling us, you know, you may not take him home, but it's gonna be a long trip from here on out. I mean, I'd never seen so many machines. There was lights and cables. He was covered in stuff. But then he started to perk, and he started to open his eyes, and they were telling us to expect 3 months. And 14 days later, our doctor, who was a believer, walked in and said, "Man, we don't know what's going on, but you're going to take your son home today." Jake was almost two, and it was time for him to have hopefully his last surgery. And this time they were going to go in and redirect more blood out to his arms and his legs, so that he'd be a little more mobile. And so we loaded everyone up again and went from Arkansas to Dallas, not knowing what to expect again, with doctors and nurses coming in, preparing us to not bring him home, and giving us all these statistics and all the odds of him not making it. At two, he had started to understand more of who we were as parents. At two, God taught me what it was like to give your son. And when the doctors came to take him, I had to give my son to people and trust that they would do something with him that I couldn't. And him hold on to me and scream for me. And now, looking back at all of it, he's seven. He'll be eight this January. At seven, he has this concept of God that I still don't think I have. And it's amazing to watch what God has taken from a 2% chance of not making it home to a seven-year-old that's going to change the world. Last year, he got to tell his first grade class what happened to his heart and how God saved him. And so my son went on 10 minutes of a gospel presentation of how he had a heart that was broken like everybody's, but that Jesus had come in and saved him and had fixed his heart, and how he can do that for you. He's telling kids about who Jesus is in a platform that I would never have had. And that's not an unusual thing for him. He does that every day. He's constantly pulling his shirt up to show people his scar and talk about how God fixed his heart. He's constantly telling people that his heart was broken, but that God fixed it. Even now, doctors really tell us they don't know what to expect from him. They tell us that most likely when he's 17 or so that he'll have a heart transplant, because what they've done to his heart is going to wear it out, and it's not going to... it's not going to last past 17 to 20, somewhere in there. I don't know what God's going to do with him, but we're still in the same place we were almost 8 years ago now, where we're just praying for God to heal him. And I still believe with all my heart that God is going to one day, is going to make his heart whole.
There's a line in the song that says, "Life is not a snapshot." And if you took a snapshot of a particular moment in Tim and Paula's life, it might not look like there's very much hope for them. But sickness and struggles are not the end of the story for those who know Jesus. Because we believe in a God who heals, we believe in a God who saves. At the end of every email I get from Tim, he always says, "Fighting the fight until I see his face." So just remember that no matter what you're struggling with, our sufferings are not worthy to be compared with the glory that is to be revealed in us. Pain and struggles are real, but we have to remember that they're only the dark before the morning. This song is for Jake and David. His name means victory through grace for God's beloved.
Would you dare to believe that you still got a reason to see? 'Cause the pain that you've been feeling, it can't compare to the joy that's coming. But would you dare to believe?